night before he was to die, Jesus went with his disciples to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to them, "Sit here while I go yonder and pray." And going a little further, he fell on his face and prayed, "My Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as thou wilt."
We have been in our country on a kind of roller coaster ride since February the 2nd, 1990, when Mr. de Klerk made his epoch-making announcement. And we have been filled with a euphoria, especially at the time of the release of Nelson Mandela. But now we have been into the depths, almost the depths of despair, because of the violence that has flared up with so many, many of our people killed. And I think for many of us, there's almost a replay of what happened to our Lord, the spitting, the being whipped so that it tore the flesh off his back, the gaping wounds. Many of our people have had that experience. Many whose only temerity was to say, "You know, we are human too. We have been made like you in the image of God. We count, we matter." And it's been quite extraordinary how many of our people have been sustained by the gospel story, the story of the God who cares so much that he dies.
While Jesus was still speaking, Judas came, one of the 12, and with him a great crowd with swords and clubs, from the chief priests and the elders of the people. Now, the betrayer had given them a sign, saying, "The one I shall kiss is the man. Seize him." And he came to Jesus at once and said, "Hail, Master!" And he kissed him. Jesus said to him, "Friend, why are you here? Would you betray the Son of Man with a kiss?" Then they came up and laid hands on Jesus and seized him. Then all the disciples forsook him and fled.
The conditions were terrible during that time because people had no places to stay. They were just staying in the shacks, and there were no schools, there were no shops, there were no clinics, there were no doctors. Things were just terrible. The only thing that was happening were getting arrested. That's all for the pass. And I fight left and right to build up a little shack where I was teaching. In 2 days' time, I had 200 children inside, so I couldn't cope with them. I asked other women to come and help me, so they were helping me, and I had no board, no chalk, nothing. I've been just using the sand to write on. So I worked there for a time, teaching in the school, working with the community after school, and 1978, where the big clash was, when there was a big fight on the 14th of September, where really people tried to fight back to the police. During that course of time, I was just in and out, detained time and again. They used to keep me for weeks. They used to keep me for months, you see, and they never really put a finger on what they want, because all the time, my base was Christianity, you see. And it's exactly what made me not to be cross with them, because I knew exactly what had happened to Jesus, you see. But they couldn't understand him, because he was a funny man. He was working on his own way, you see, which I think, if really you are a Christian, it's what we have to do. He had no sides.
When morning came, they bound Jesus and took him away and delivered him to Pilate the governor. And the governor asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus said to him, "You have said so." But when he was accused by the chief priests and elders, he made no answer. Then Pilate said to him, "Do you not hear how many things they testify against you?" But he gave him no answer, not even to a single charge, so that the governor wondered greatly.
Yeah.
injustice, oppression, dehumanize the oppressor as much as, if not more than, the oppressed. And then you see, when a Steve Biko dies, a cabinet minister can say, addressing a political rally, that the death of Steve Biko leaves him cold. And you say, what could have happened to the humanity of a person who can actually say about the death of a fellow human being that it leaves him cold? God says, how can you say you love me, whom you have not seen, if you hate your brother, whom you have? Don't be silly. If you want to know who I, God, am, then turn around and look at your neighbor. Jesus said, we're not going to be judged on whether we were praying or went into church, but whether we fed the hungry, clothed the naked, visited the sick. I have never yet heard the hungry, the naked, the oppressed, the exploited say, Bishop Tutu, you are being too political in speaking up for our rights. The people who say don't mix religion with politics almost always are benefiting from that particular status quo which is being criticized. And if God was a God only concerned with my soul and my spirit, I would have no truck with such a God. Wonderfully, wonderfully, our God is a God who says, I care about your whole life. And Jesus suffers and dies because of his identification with those whom the world thinks don't count.
Then the soldiers of the governor took Jesus into the praetorium, and they stripped him and put a scarlet robe upon him, and plaiting a crown of thorns, they put it on his head and put a reed in his right hand. And kneeling before him, they mocked him, saying, Hail, King of the Jews! And they spat upon him and took the reed and struck him on the head. And when they had mocked him, they stripped him of the robe and put his own clothes on him and led him away to crucify him.
When I was Bishop of Johannesburg, some of the people in Soweto had decided they would protest. And the young people in the township decided to put up roadblocks and barricades to stop the police from having access, easy access to their homes. The police decided on a brutal and efficient way of breaking this resistance. They went into homes, and where there were boys, they didn't ask whether you had helped to put up a barricade or not. They just said, get outside. And in the case of one family, there was a boy, there were two boys. The elder was, I think, 13 years old. The police came and asked them to get out and then chased them, whipping them all the while. And then as the boys ran off, the police shot at them. One boy was shot. The bullet entered through the back of his head and just behind the ear and through one eye. That was a fatal shot. His brother, his younger brother, was shot in the stomach. They happened to be an Anglican family, and their rector asked me to accompany him to this home. Just one of the usual matchbox type of homes that people have grown accustomed to. We came inside, and the mother, you could see, was almost sort of shell-shocked. She was sitting on a chair, and we came in. I've never felt more like a fraud trying to talk to her about the love of God. And she sat there in front of us. And she kept wiping her eyes. But there were no tears. And it seemed to me almost as if she was trying to remove from in front of her face images she couldn't bear to look on. One son dead, another critically injured in hospital. And so many times I have said to our people, you see, the system is evil, totally without remainder. And we must not be surprised that it has to use equally evil methods to defend itself. And that in the course of the struggle, there will be casualties. People will be arrested, tortured, will go into exile, and people will be killed for the price of freedom is high.
As they were marching out, they came upon a man of Cyrene, Simon by name. This man they compelled to carry Jesus' cross. And when they came to a place called Golgotha, which means the place of a skull, there they crucified him and the criminals, one on the right and one on the left. And Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And they cast lots to divide his garments. And the people stood by watching. And the rulers scoffed at him, saying, He saved others, let him save himself, if he is the Christ of God, his chosen one. And over his head, they put the charge against him, which read, This is the King of the Jews.
Oh.
Ashley was organizing at schools, school level, and I didn't actually know about this. Actually, I knew, but I didn't know it was a danger. I didn't know it was wrong if you speak for each other or you stand up for your rights. We also, when I was young, we accepted it. We thought it must be like that. And but he said to me, no, we're all South Africans. Why? Is it now because the white, they get the better education? He said to me, no, mommy, it's our rights to get a good education. So once the inter-school, the three schools of Bonteville, they decided they're going to march all together. And they met at the civic center, and they were walking the roads. And then, of course, the army were called in, and they just hit left and right the children with, and sprayed them with tear gas and batons, charge them and so on. Then since that night he didn't come home. Then after a few weeks I got word that he is no more in the country. He left the country. But I thought that he, you know, not knowing much about politics, I thought that he went away for some studies where he could go on with his studies. Then afterwards that I heard that he went for guerrilla training. And it was in 1985 I saw him last, and then in 1987, I was sitting in a bus coming from work. So someone was reading the evening paper in the bus, and I was just looking over his shoulder, and I saw this headlines that a terrorist was shot in Athlone, a 19-year-old man. So I thought to myself, I wonder who could this be? Is it perhaps one of the Africans, you know, like we always used to think it can only be Africans. We never used to think that there's also in our communities youth that is also fighting for freedom. So then the next morning, then it was announced over the radio that Ashley Creel was shot dead. So when we didn't know actually what happened and where it happened, but with my daughter identifying this the body, she saw on the desk that it happened in Athlone, and she also got the address there, and we went there immediately. When we went there, we saw all the splashes of blood in the main room as we came in, and outside, and there was a spade also lying. And she said that she went in, and there was some of the clothes lying in blood, you know, full of blood spots and so on. They actually said in the papers, in the newspapers, that he shot himself, but he was handcuffed. And he shot himself, he killed himself. And that was so funny, you know. It was, how could you be handcuffed and shoot yourself, kill yourself? And actually the wound came from the back. In one way, I feel happy, because he died for freedom, he died fighting for the people. And it shows that. And he showed me his niece, my granddaughter, and said to her,
Listen, he said, my girl, one day you will have a better education and Uncle Ashley, we will fight and you will see one day that you will get a better education. He said, mommy, you will die and you will be old, and he said, you will also die. But at least we fought for those that's still coming for the next generation. And he said to me, even if you don't see it one day, he knows that the next generation, the children, they will reap the benefits of it.
And one of the criminals were hanged, railed at Jesus, saying, are you not the Christ? Save yourself and us. But the other rebuked him, saying, do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we indeed justly, for we are receiving the due reward of our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong. And he said, Jesus, remember me when you come to your kingdom. And he said to him, truly, I say to you, today you will be with me in paradise.
We are saying, in being involved in the liberation struggle to free blacks, we are almost paradoxically also concerned for the liberation of white people. And I've sometimes told stories and told the story of an old film, The Defiant Ones. It's the story of two convicts who escape. They are manacled together. One of them is black and the other is white. And they fall into a ditch with their slippery sides. And one of the convicts is able to claw his way nearly to the top. But he can't make it because he's still manacled to his mate down there. And he slithers to the bottom. The only way they can make it is if they go up, up, up. together. And we have said at home in South Africa, the only way we will ever be free is together, black and white. The only way we can be human is together, black and white. The only way we can survive is together, black and white. Because our humanity is bound up in one another's. In our languages, we speak of something called ubuntu, botho, the essence of being human. It shows itself in being hospitable, being generous, being affirming of others, being compassionate, being caring. And how desperately we want our white fellow South Africans to know that when we are diminished, they are diminished as well, and that they will not be free until we are free.
Voilà. You've got to twist right round.
Okay. You've got to twist,
but you've got to keep your feet still. That's it. Okay, can you manage like that?
Yeah,
your feet must stay straight. That's right. Okay. And a catch, and a catch. Take it.
Thinking back to my childhood, really, in the 40s, I remember wonderful relationships between the older generation and black people, but always a paternalistic relationship. My grandmother, for instance, on their farm in the Free State, always spoke Sotho to her retainers and servants, and she seemed to have a great rapport with them. And yet I noticed, of course, that they were desperately poor, these workers. And later on, I realized that they were being paid partly in cash, but partly giving them a bit of land to use, and then supplying so many bags of mealies or whatever for them to plant and then make a living out of that. And the bits of land weren't very large, and I think they stayed poor all their lives on the farm. There was a moment at which real Christian concern stopped, and they were seen as different, as black, as not the same as us, not really human. I think that I just couldn't understand how the church could remain quiet and keep remaining quiet about apartheid. And it became an awful embarrassment to me, and a great sadness.
I thought that I hadn't been influenced by stereotypes, but I had. You can't help it if you live in a white society. You can't get away from it. And just realizing that I was influenced by it, and I had to consciously fight that. I had to consciously realize that I was, you know, being sort of mind-washed. Our family doesn't go to rallies, and we don't, you know, fly banners and all that sort of thing. But, you know, we are clearly against it, and very, very relieved that it's almost gone. And it was very difficult, you know, at times to live with the fact that you're white, and that makes you guilty, because there are other whites who have done this to the people. I had a very excellent experience last year. At the beginning of last year, I went on a thing called the Edu Train. I was selected to go on that. There were four people from our school who went. It was 60 standard nines who went for 10 days together. We were flown out to Joburg, and then we went on a specially modified train down to Durban and back up. And it was a kind of intensive leadership program. And also it was carefully sort of worked out so that there were, I think it was sort of 25 white kids and colored kids and black kids. And that was really excellent, because it was real mixing. I mean, we had this one incredible session where our sort of facilitator was encouraging us to come to sort of express all the fears and all the angers and things that we'd had up to now. And we all ended up just crying and bawling and just hugging each other and carrying on. And that was the first time that I'd actually sort of, you know, hugged a black boy. And it was a very intense experience, and we all came off on this incredible high.
We seem to be starting to becoming clear of the color problem. I don't think have got anywhere near the class problem. So yeah, I think that one kind of problems is starting to go, but I don't think that means blue skies and clear sailing automatically at all.
In the 50s, when I was a teenager, and I started becoming aware of political happenings, I remember often feeling quite afraid, especially learning at school about things like the French Revolution. I couldn't but help see the similarities between that society and ours. I think my work has been very important because it's helped me keep in touch with what's been happening outside our secluded white suburb. Keka is one of my pupils in Standard 10 in her final year, and she has to pass Afrikaans at the end of the year to gain university entrance, and it's a great struggle for her. She's already trilingual. She can speak Xhosa, Zulu and English, and this Afrikaans is really a trial. And I bring her home every week for a day, and then we chat together. We bake biscuits, or we go to see a show or something, and the idea is just to give her more confidence with her speech. And then I go through her written work, and she sleeps over, and then I take her to school the next day. I think the Good Friday message of suffering and then later forgiveness is so vivid. It's suffering which is such a part of this society, and I think that forgiveness, if it comes, will be a wonderful, wonderful blessing. I think that the black people in South Africa are amazingly forgiving. And it's been a constant source of wonder to us how patient and gentle and forgiving the black people are whom we've met and spoken to. The time to come, the next few months, could be wonderful. It could be, if things go well and hope generates hope, we might all feel different people. But I think, on the other hand, we are almost afraid to hope. There's so much that has to be set right.
South Africa, there have often been occasions when people thought that reconciliation meant papering over cracks, crying peace, peace, where there is no peace. And we've had to tell them that true reconciliation involves a proper confrontation. after all, reconciliation cost God the death of his son. True reconciliation can be very costly. And yet, as soon as someone who has wronged confesses and is penitent, then the wronged is constrained by the gospel to forgive. We are in the business of forgiveness. And our faith is tremendous in the fact that it is a faith of ever new beginnings. Because God does not give up on anyone. And we who are the followers of the Son of this God have to be willing to accept the pain of forgiving. But those who are forgiven must also be ready to show the genuineness of their penitence. It's no good saying, Bishop Tutu, I'm sorry, I stole your pen. Whilst you retain my pen, you show that you are in earnest by returning my pen. And so in our country, we have been saying, please, there is going to have to be restitution. People, 3.5 million people have been uprooted and taken away from their homes and dumped, often in poverty-stricken resettlement camps. And some of their land is still empty. And we have been trying to persuade our government that they ought to restore what has been taken away from people. Our country is needing healing.
If I've got hope, it's easy to forgive. Because I've got hope that we'll have a new South Africa one day. Therefore, I have to forgive them. All of us have got mistakes. But the mistakes that can be forgiven. Yes, they've done a lot to us. Yes, they've done a lot to us. Even the policemen who were really nasty to me, but I have changed them to be my friends. And to understand the humans. And to understand their rights as well. So I did that up to 1986. And when my house burnt down in 1986, although I knew that they didn't understand, they didn't know what they were doing, but a little bit I felt that now I must cover another area of language, and area of more understanding that were also people. And then I find the school. So I'm teaching now in the white school, teaching in Waldorf school. And I feel very much happy to be there. It's a multiracial school. It's a community school. To me, it's exactly what I would like to see South Africa in the near future. Because I'm the only black teacher. But I'm just saying that I'm the only black teacher. I never felt that way in that school. I feel I'm just a teacher among the other teachers, which is we are very much happy together. So that alone is telling me that one day we'll have a beautiful South Africa.
Now, there comes a woman. She has got a shawl and a baby at the back. Where am I going to fix that lady? Which I'm going to be with Mary. And slowly. Okay, hold on.
As a teacher, you don't jump to politics all the time to your pupils. But whenever an incident happened, I sit down and tell them. And you will find that some of them, they don't believe these things that really are happening to people. To my high school children sometimes, when I'm having a main lesson, I'm taking them out from Constantia, putting them in the township. Say, for instance, last year, I put them in the little shops inside B, in the squatter camp. I want them to know that there are people who are living there, and those people are the same like them, although they're in the shacks, but they're the same like them. The life is the same. I don't blame anyone who feels bitter and angry, but I'm against somebody who feels bitter and angry forever. Because now you have given up yourself if you are angry forever. If you are bitter forever, that means you are angry with yourself now. You are no more angry with your enemy, whoever.
And Jesus cried with a loud voice, "Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani?" That is, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?" And there was darkness over the whole land until the ninth hour, while the sun's light failed. Then Jesus cried again with a loud voice, "Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit." And having said this, he breathed his last.
On Good Friday, there was a darkness that covered the face of the earth, a darkness that seemed to reflect the despair and the desolation in the hearts of those who followed Jesus. Nothing could have been more hopeless than this young man who had made many people believe that good would overcome evil. Nothing could have been more hopeless than this young man hanging impotently on the cross. Evil, rampant evil, appeared to have done its worst, and rampant evil seemed to be going to have the last word. For he had no guarantee that dying, he would rise, that there was life after death. He had to take a chance. He had to take the risk of faith, make that leap, and hope that on the other side there would be the everlasting arms to hold him up. And then, hey, Easter happened, and he broke the bonds of death, and forever, Christians must be prisoners of hope. For now, it is clear, no situation can ever be totally irredeemable. And we have said here at home to our people in the dark, dark days, you know, the darkest hours, they say, are before the dawn. And even when dark clouds cover the face of the heavens, you know that the sun is shining behind those clouds. And so we have said to our people, there is no way in which injustice and oppression and evil can have the last word. The last word is the love of God prevailing, the goodness of God prevailing, and we too can begin to see a little of this happening in our country as apartheid is being dismantled, as we stand on the threshold of exciting possibilities. Yes, there are going to be very many obstacles. Yes, there will be those who seek to subvert the possibilities of this new dispensation, of this new South Africa, democratic, non-racial, non-sexist. And sometimes we will wonder whether it is going to happen at all. But I have no doubt. I have no doubt that we will be free. I have no doubt that this new South Africa is going to happen for all of us in this country. And then we will ask, why were we so crazy? Why were we so stupid for so long? Because you see, we know that we are loved with a love that will not let us go. We are loved with a love that says, your name is engraved on the palms of God's hands. You are known by name. And we can exult with St. Paul and say, if God be for us, who can be against us? And with Dame Julian of Norwich, we will be able to say, all manner of things shall be well.
Thank you.